Good evening, everybody. This is Brother Lloyd. Today's subject is titled Obedience, a Test of Our Faithfulness. We're going to talk about some of the issues that surround death because it brings about all sorts of chaos, confusion, and misunderstanding. But I'm going to address some of these according to the Word of the Most High because there's so many things that we're challenged about in our lives. And most of them are a test of our faithfulness, a test of our willingness to stand for the Word of God. So with that being said, let's get started. October 15th, 2016, my grandmother fell on sleep, or she died, and she's now resting in the grave until the resurrection, or the second coming, says the Word of the Most High, not me. She will shortly in the grave see corruption, as we all will, where we will go when it's our time. Now, sadly, some will meet this fate sooner than later. But this did bring to mind another thought in the midst of all the never-ending confusion about what truly happens when we die. What were we before the Most High created us? Now, some will say dust, but that's not really accurate. The correct answer is nothing. Then he said to his son, and God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. Genesis 1:26. So we are created from an idea. And I speak those words lightly, but it's more like a plan that the Most High made with His Son. In His creating of us, He used the dust of the ground, which already existed, in the breath of life, which He provided, which already existed. So we were nothing, in essence, before He created us out of these two elements. These two elements. So my point is this. The Word tells us that when we die, our body goes back to the earth or to the dust from which it came, and the breath of life or air that He breathed into us goes back to Him who gave it. So wouldn't it be accurate to say that if these two things are true, then there's no separate being that leaves our body when we die that goes to heaven or hell? The Most High did not put an additional being within us, or His Word would say different. He says that we were created of the dust and of His breath. So this spiritual being thing that people talk about or are taught, supposedly that leaves us when we die and goes to heaven or hell, is a lie according to the Word. This is a teaching of man. The truth is in the Word, people. The truth of this type of teaching is another study, though. So for now, I digress. The passing of my grandmother also brought to mind another constant agonizing dilemma for those who worship on the Most High's truly holy day that He sanctified by His Word, not mine. This, of course, for those who aren't aware, would be the seventh day of the week, or the Sabbath day, not to be confused with a Sabbath day, which, yes, technically can be any day, but I'm speaking about the one and the only one that he has sanctified and made holy, Saturday. Now, technically, again, we're speaking about Friday at sunset until Saturday sunset, according to Exodus 20, verses 8 through 11, which read, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy." And we keep it holy by meditating in a spiritual rest, by hearing the word of the Most High, and by resting from worldly travails. Verse 9, 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, all thy worldly work, all things that can be done in those 6 days should be done. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle or beast, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in six days, the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. He sanctified it. He set it apart from the other 6 days of the week, people. He sanctioned this day as a holy day to be honored and blessed so that it may be a blessing to us. So that is the most important day of the week. Forever. It's not going to change. This is one of his commandments, which he wrote with his finger in stone. It does not change. It is perpetual. Now, I have been asked about attending events and doing other worldly things on the Sabbath of the Most High, the one that he sanctified, the one that he made holy. He just clearly told us in his word that it is a set apart day from all the other 6 days. His word is clear and simple. If it is not pertaining to the Sabbath, if it's not something spiritual and holy, according to his word, it can wait. Even our conversation. So we better watch, and we need to be watching what we say on his sanctified holy day. Now, the one event that many of us like to make an exception for is a funeral. By attaching some sort of holy or sanctified or spiritual sanctity to it, or some kind of special authority or feel to it that puts it in the category of being acceptable. Now, one may say, surely God doesn't object to someone attending a funeral on the Sabbath. Let me attack this on two fronts quickly. Sabbath keepers, some, struggle with this same issue because most funerals are on the Sabbath or Saturday. Sunday keepers, in their defense or making justification for a Sabbath keeper who is in a conflict about whether to go to a funeral or not on the Sabbath, will say, surely God wouldn't object to someone attending a funeral on the Sabbath. So both classes can approach this same issue in terms of attending a funeral on the Sabbath. But see, for Sunday keepers, this is never a conflict, or better said, this is rarely a issue because they worship on a different day, which is Sunday, and rarely, if ever, are Sunday keepers asked to attend or even have a funeral on Sunday, because Sunday is their reverence day of worship. See, they pick another day to bury our lost loved ones, which is typically Friday or Saturday, because it's more convenient for all involved due to a myriad of logistical issues or what have you. This reasoning is prevalent by most and even common by many Sabbath keepers desiring to cater to their sense of obligation, to their emotions, to family who wish to justify their own reasons to attend a funeral on the Sabbath. Now, I get it, but the bottom line is that it disagrees with the word of the Most High, whether we like it or not. This now becomes a trial of our obedience to the truth of His word. And what is the truth of His word? Go with me to Acts 13, 33 through 37, which reads, God hath fulfilled the same unto us, their children, in that He hath raised up Jesus again, as it is also written in the second Psalm, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. And as concerning that He raised him up from the dead, now no more to return to corruption. He hath on the wise, I will give you the sure mercies of David. Wherefore He saith also in another psalm, Thou shalt not suffer thine holy one to see corruption. For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell on sleep and was laid unto his fathers and saw corruption. But he whom God raised again saw no corruption. Now, in Acts 13, 33 through 37, he's showing us his son's death and resurrection, and by comparison, what ours will be using King David, whom we all know he loved. In fact, the word tells us that he was a man after the Most High's own heart when he was walking upright or righteously. Acts 13, 21 and 22 reads, And afterward they desired a king, and God gave unto them Saul, the son of Cis, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, by the space of 40 years. Note, all that the Most High had given His people wasn't enough for them. They still desired a king. They still wanted a man to lead them. And one of the things they found out very quickly, and we should take note of this, is that when the Most High anoints someone, that doesn't mean that they will always walk in His ways. Man is still fallible because self can get in the way. If we accept what the Most High gives us and trust and obey His word, we can never go wrong. And second note, just as they wanted a king to lead them, many of you out there want a man to lead you. And typically and generally, spiritually, you want a man to lead you from a pulpit. I'm telling you, King Saul showed you that just because a man is anointed as a leader doesn't mean he's always leading according to the Most High. He can fall from that leadership. This is why we should be in the Word ourselves. But then in verse 22, he says this of David. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave their testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. Now, the Most High shows us by comparison that Christ was raised from the dead without seeing corruption or decay like David, whom he loved exceedingly. But nonetheless, we are told that he was buried and saw corruption, speaking of David. So people, understand that even Christ, when he died as a man in the flesh, was buried in the grave intact. There was no separate spirit that came out of him and went to heaven while he was in the tomb. Don't believe me? Go with me to John 20, 17. It reads, Jesus saith unto her, Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father. Christ, which is risen, is not to be sought after in this world according to the flesh, but in heaven by faith. where he is gone before us. This is part of the message in that. But the primary point was to show us, or show in the word, that if Christ coming out of the grave says that he hasn't ascended, meaning he hasn't been to heaven or to his Father yet, and we know that he was in the tomb, then in essence, he's verifying by his word that he was in the tomb the whole time until he came out, intact, in sleep, death, dead, at rest. One, also because it was the Sabbath. He kept the Sabbath. He was at rest on the Sabbath. Completely. No spiritual presence within him floated out and went up to heaven or anywhere else to have a conversation with his Father or anything else. He verified it by his word. He says, I have not yet. Means I haven't done it yet. I was in the tomb. I just come out. Don't touch me. I haven't been glorified yet. Think about this, people. His word is not convoluted in any way. The word of the Most High speaks to us simply and clearly. Now, our deceased loved ones, where are they? They are in the grave, seeing corruption, just like David. And the breath that the Most High puts in us and gives us all goes back to him who gave it. Not a spiritual being. Two elements, people. We talked about that at the beginning. Now, the teaching of beings within us and things of that nature is what's called spiritualism. And this comes from the adversary. He uses man to teach it, but it comes from him. But the word, it is simply speaking of breath. The breath when it comes to death. Now, the word spirit in the Hebrew, Strong's number 7307, simply means breath, air.